We don't know the specifics of the circumstances here of David's writing, but it's very clear that there's some sort of attack, some sort of opposition that is there. It could be from outside Israel, another nation. It could be from within. We know from David's history there was a lot of turmoil, even with his own family and those who were close to him. But throughout the psalm, it's categorized as a psalm of confidence because God is still God. And David makes it very, very clear that that is where his mind, his heart is at. By way of reminder, the psalms are written, there's a human author. They're poems, they're songs, they're prayers. They're to God, but they're also inspired by God. It's God's word from him to us. And so there's that double focus there. So I asked myself as I was studying this week, why does David express such deep, unwavering confidence in God? What does God communicate to David as he's praying to him? There's truths that we'll look at today that we need to wholeheartedly believe, and we need to demonstrate that belief by a faithful response. In thinking through this, there was a time in my life where I had my own prayer of confidence, if you will. It was a difficult time. There was not a human enemy per se, but there certainly was opportunity to be discouraged and tempted and doubt and so on. And as I reflected back on that season, I remember praying many, many times. And I use the word if, and it's really since. If God, you are holy and sovereign, if you are that God that I've believed and you claim and reveal yourself to be, and since you really have done, or if you've done what you've done in Christ, if you're orchestrating history as you have, if you have promised, therefore I must, or therefore I can, therefore I will, based on who you are and what you've done and what you've promised, I can do something. I can, in your strength, in your power, I can have confidence based on who you are. And I believe that's where David was. So sort of the conclusion of the matter in verse 14, David says, wait for the Lord. Be strong. Let your heart take courage. Wait for the Lord. Literally, that means look eagerly for. Look eagerly for the Lord. Be strong. Take courage. Look eagerly for the Lord. And this is in the midst of some intense opposition. I'll use some words interchangeably, confidence, we'll see that in a psalm. Trust, faith, hope, they're all synonyms for waiting on the Lord. We're going to take a look at five reasons why the disciple of Jesus Christ can wait on the Lord. And after each one, I'll guide us in a faithful prayer of confidence based on what we just looked at. Before we read, let's ask the Lord for his help. Holy Father, I pray this morning as we consider Psalm 27 that we would see your wonderful character on full display. Lord, that we would see how you have loved us and has cared for us, and in Christ you have given us a new life. And in Christ we have hope. Father, may you help us today so that we would be a people who wait for you, who are strong and our hearts are encouraged, waiting on you. Do your work in us, we pray. Amen. Psalm 27, I think in the confusion with the kids, it's on page 460 if you're going to use the Bibles that are provided for us in the chairs. Psalm 27, it's of David. The Lord is my light and my salvation, whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life, of whom shall I be afraid? When evildoers assail me to eat up my flesh, my adversaries and foes, it is they who stumble and fall. Though an army encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war arise against me, yet I will be confident. One thing I have asked of the Lord that I will seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. For he will hide me in his shelter in the day of trouble. He will conceal me under the cover of his tent. He will lift me high upon a rock. And now my head shall be lifted up above my enemies all around me. I will offer in his tent sacrifices with shouts of joy. I will sing and make melody to the Lord. Hear, O Lord, when I cry aloud. Be gracious to me and answer me. You have said, seek my face. My heart says to you, your face, Lord, do I seek. Hide not your face from me. Turn not your servant away in anger. O you have been my help. Cast me not off. Forsake me not, O God of my salvation. For my father and my mother have forsaken me, but the Lord will take me in. Teach me your way, O Lord, and lead me on a level path because of my enemies. Give me not up to the will of my adversaries, for false witnesses have risen against me, and they breathe out violence. I believe that I shall look upon the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord. Be strong and let your hearts take courage. Wait for the Lord. The first thing we see that a disciple of Christ can wait on the Lord is that the Lord is our source of confidence. As you might have noticed, as throughout, the David uses the name of God, Lord. In our English translations, it's all caps. And so that should signify to us that this is the name of the Lord, the Yahweh. This is the existing one. This is the name that God gave to Moses at the burning bush, I am. He is signifies that he's above all things, even the enemy, even the attack, even the feelings of desperation that no doubt David had experienced. The one that David finds his faith, his confidence in is that one, the existing one. He says, he uses three other names, if you will, for God, is my light, my salvation, and my stronghold. And in way David's using these names, these concepts as figurative. Light often in Scripture is used as divine holiness. It depicts life and truth. It's always positive. It's always good. We know that life always overcomes darkness of evil. Here in the midst of the attack, it's probably more referring to that God is his light. He exposes the enemy. David knows their plans. David maybe through God's revealing might know who his real enemies are. God is his salvation. Of course, as New Testament believers, we think of the cross. David's probably more of deliverance and rescue from a particular situation, particular enemies. For those who oppose God, and as David is seeking the Lord, they're opposed to him as well. Of course, there's a deeper than just simply a physical rescue, but there's spiritual connotations there as well, that God takes care of his own. And we'll see that throughout this psalm. God is his stronghold or refuge. It's a strong, fortified place. If God is that place, as we'll see, it's figurative. Let me tell you a little story. I'll leave out a lot of the details, but a story that kind of helps illustrate the intangible or the figurative concepts that can be tangible. And how trusting and having confidence that the Lord is light and salvation and stronghold really do bring confidence and dispel fear. In college, I was hiking with several folks, and it was in the springtime during spring break, and so the river was a little bit more wild than normal. and there were several of us, and we had to cross this. It was not a stream, it was a river. And in order to cross, there was no bridge. We had to wade or fjord, but the water's racing. And so there wasn't like a little lily pad rocks to go. These were boulders, and they were spread out quite a bit. And really only the track stars were able to go from rock to rock without getting their boots all wet. And myself and another girl was left on one side and everybody else had gone across. And she was terrified. Absolutely. I didn't know if we were ever going to get her across. She was terrified. But as we tried to encourage her and prayed, and she prayed, this is not biblical, but she imagined the rocks as marshmallows. Kind of weird. Anyway, but she's terrified, so weird things happen when you're terrified, apparently. So she imagined the rocks as marshmallows. But in the midst of that, she was saying, she was praying, God, you protect me. She was reminding herself of God's character. She was reminding herself of God's promises so that she could face something that was absolutely terrifying. It's exactly what I think David is doing in the midst of this. He's reminding that the Lord, the sovereign one, the one that has always existed, is my light, my salvation, and my stronghold. So then he can say, fear is gone, and even though the army is in camp around me, I have confidence because God's bigger. And so I'd like to say that we got across without getting our feet wet, but both her and I didn't quite make it all to each of the leaps. But by God's strength and trusting in him, we were able to overcome that fear. David says that the Lord is my light. It's personal. It's intimate. That girl could not say, Lord, you are wonderful to me. You're my Savior, if there was no relationship there. So these truths that we'll talk about today, they're not for those who reject the Lord, who are not do not have faith in Jesus Christ, but they are for those who do. Therefore, if our faith is in Christ, we can wait on the Lord as our source of confidence. The answer to fear, as David points out here, is God himself. That is the answer. He is the light. He's the one that dispels the fear. There was an email devotion from Paul Tripp that came through this week, and I just want to read a couple sentences. I think it speaks to this truth. Our hope is not found in our own willingness and ability to endure, and in our context here, to overcome fear, but in God's unshakable, enduring commitment to never turn from his work of grace. Our hope is that your hope is that you have been welcomed into communion with the one who will endure no matter what. Our hope of enduring is not found in our own character or strength, but in the Lord's, because God will ever be faithful. You can bank on the fact that he will give you what you need to be faithful. When difficulty exposes our weakness of our resolve and limits our strength, or in times of fear, we do not have to panic, because he will endure. He will endure in those moments when we don't feel that we're able to do so ourselves. So whether it's crossing a stream, facing a difficult season, whatever it may be, it is the Lord who can and will give confidence and trust to those who are his. You remember Jesus in John 14, he says to his disciples right before going to the cross, he's taught them that he's going to die. He says, don't be troubled. Believe in God and believe also in me. I'm going to prepare a place for you, and I'm going to come back and take you so we can be together. And Philip says, and he promises his return, and Philip says, well, show us the Father. And Jesus, in a very loving way, says, I have shown you the Father. Remember what I've taught you? Remember what I've done? Think of that. I've revealed the Father. Therefore, you don't have to be troubled. You don't have to fear. For what I've done and what I've taught you and what I've promised, you can have confidence in. We need to remember that truth. We need to remember the truth of who God is and that he cares for us. God, you are our light and our salvation and our stronghold. You have rescued us in the past, and you promised to take care of us today and in the future. Father, we confess that in Christ we don't have to be afraid, even in the midst of scary circumstances. We can trust in you. We can wait for you. Amen. Our second reason we see in verses 4 through 6. Let me read that again. One thing I have asked of the Lord that I will seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in His temple. For He will hide me in His shelter in the day of trouble. He will conceal me under the cover of His tent. He will lift me high on a rock. And now my head shall be lifted up above my enemies all around me. I will offer in His tent sacrifices with shouts of joy. I will sing and make melody to the Lord. This second reason the disciple of Christ can wait on the Lord is because His presence is all that we truly need, and it is readily available. In the first few verses, we see that David's confidence is built and rooted upon God's proven character. Well, here it is rooted in God's presence. David uses imagery of being in the house of the Lord or in the temple where God's on earth, His manifestation of His presence was. David longs to be there, to be with God. Notice the beginning of verse 4, there's a devotion and even a determination to be with God. One thing I have asked and that I will seek after. David is determined. It's not a passive thing for him. With the one thing that he's asked for, what is this one thing that he's seeking after? It's the single most important, it's the ultimate purpose. It's his greatest delight, his deepest desire, and it's God Himself. In the Garden of Eden, in the very moment when mankind stepped away from seeking and desiring that one thing, that God Himself, is the moment sin entered the world. Adam and Eve, and we do as well. We settle for much, much less. David here, in the midst of his turmoil, his struggle, he's seeking after God Himself. He's not seeking anything temporary or material, but he's desiring God's presence. That phrase, I will seek after, has the idea of in order to secure, in order to take hold of. How does David take hold of God? I ask myself that question. Take hold of someone we can't wrap our brains, our hands around. Well, the answer is in the rest of what David says in verse 4, at least part of the answer. He's in the presence of God. He's dwelling, he's gazing, he's beholding the beauty or the delightfulness of God. He's meditating, he's considering, he's remembering who God is and what He's done and what He's promised. We do that as individuals, we do that as families, we do that as a body. We need to, and as part of our worship on Sunday mornings, we gather, and our hope is that Christ's character and His work would be made very, very clear and very manifest. So that we are led to worship. If David was not seeking the Lord, if we do not seek the Lord, we do not have the desire for the Lord. Just like in the garden, we step away and we settle for much less. But when we take the time, when we make the time, regular time throughout the day, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord, we have to worship. Because He is worthy of it. He's not a little puny God. He's the I Am. And so when we take the time, make the time to gaze upon Him, we worship, and all the cares of the world fade away. There's a song, Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus. But when we concentrate on the enemy, when we concentrate on our circumstances, we get so nearsighted, we forget about God. David's content, David's determined not to fall into that trap and settling less. One commentator said this way, the preoccupation with God's presence is the essence of our worship and our discipleship. If we're preoccupied with God's presence, with His wonderful character, we're going to worship and we're going to want to live for Him. this closeness and this lifting up when we do seek the Lord leads us to worship and to honor Him. So are you seeking and finding God, or are we settling for other things? Similar to our challenge from last week with the idols, what are we seeking after? Are we settling for much less? And this has come up several times as I've been studying. Why would God not want to answer that prayer? God, I want to know you more. Teach me. Let me know that you're near. Why would God not want to answer that prayer? Father God, you are wonderful in every way. In Christ, we are lifted up. We're exalted over our enemies, and you promise to hide us and conceal us and lift us up in our day of trouble. Therefore, Lord, we seek you, and we worship your great name. Amen. The third reason the disciple of Christ can wait on the Lord: the Lord will never forsake his children. Look at 7 through 10 again. Hear, O Lord, when I cry aloud, be gracious to me and answer me. You have said, seek my face. My heart says to you, your face, Lord, do I seek. Hide not your face from me. Turn not your servant away in anger. You have been my help. Cast me not off. Forsake me not, O God of my salvation. For my father and my mother have forsaken me, but the Lord will take me in. Again, David does not ask that the Lord would judge his enemies. We looked at a psalm a couple weeks ago that was part of the prayer. But here he asks for grace in verse 7. Be gracious and answer me. And we'll talk about in the verses that follow what that looks like. And in verse 12, he asks not to suffer under his enemies' will, what they would want, how David to suffer. But again, David is desiring something more beyond even better circumstances. But he's desiring God himself. And I think that's what verse 8, David speaks about. And says that, God, you have said, seek my face. It's a command. And in the Hebrew, that's a plural. So he's saying, God, you've told your people to seek you. And David says, my heart says to you, I will seek. That's his response. God, you've said to do something, therefore I'm going to do it. But notice his heart says. It's not outward compliance. It's not going through the motions. It is deep. It is personal. It is David longs for God himself. And as I alluded to just a moment ago, God will be found. If God commands us, seek, he's not going to hide and not be found. He's going to reveal himself. So as a child of God, we can be confident that if we pray according to what God wants in us and for us, that he will do it. Yet verse 9 and 10, David says, hide not your face. It appears that God is not there, that God's not listening, that he's slow to answer and to relieve David of the situation. And maybe that's how David has felt. I know I have felt that way at times. As if David is saying, Lord, you have said to seek you, and I am, but it seems like you're still hiding. Yet he comes around in verse 10 at the end, but the Lord will take me in. Literally, the Lord will care for me. David's confidence is rooted in that as a servant, as a child of God, that God's not going to kick him to the curb. The ultimate example of this is Christ. He kept trusting the Father while he was enduring the cross. Let's consider briefly 1 Peter chapter 2. Should be on the screen for us. Here we are. For to this you have been called, because Christ, who suffered for you, leaving an example, that you might follow in his footsteps. He committed no sin, neither was there deceit found in his mouth. When he was reviled, he did not revile in return. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but continued entrusting himself to him who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed. For you who were strained like sheep, but now return to the shepherd and overseer of your souls. As Jesus, the Son of God, fully human, yet did not sin. He was hanging on the cross alone, bearing the sin and guilt that we deserve. As Jesus hung, you remember, he cried out, "Father, why have you forsaken me?" It was because of our sin. Yet the whole time, Christ continued to trust himself to the Father who judges justly. The sinless one being punished for yours and my sin, so that we could, as Peter says, die to sin and live to righteousness. He was entrusting the Father's master plan. He endured the cross so that we could be healed. He kept trusting. He kept looking expectantly for the Lord. Jesus, you are the Son of God. You have fully dealt with our sin before the Father, and you've made us alive in what you have done. You have promised the Holy Spirit to dwell in us, to help us to endure all things. Therefore, Lord, we seek you with all of our heart, and we continue to trust in you who judges justly. Amen. The fourth reason, a way that the disciple of Christ can wait for the Lord, verse 11 and 12, David says, "Teach me your way, O Lord. Lead me on a level path because of my enemies. Give me not up to the will of my adversaries, for false witnesses have risen against me, and they breathe out violence." The Lord's ways are always best. So we can have confidence in him. We can wait on him because we know that his ways are always best. He says, "Teach me your way. Lead me on a level path," that God-centered submission. Because of his enemies. I find it interesting, that phrase, "Teach me your way, lead me on," because of my enemies. Let's consider that passage again from 1 Peter, especially verse 22 and following. "Christ committed no sin, neither was there deceit found in his mouth. When he was reviled, he did not revile in return. When he suffered, he did not threaten." Obviously, we know Christ had the power to call down in angels and deal with the situation. We know that. You know, he trusted the Lord. He trusted the Father. What if Christ would have reviled? What if he would have mocked back, threatened back? He would be with sin then. That would then he couldn't, you know, be our perfect sacrifice. What if he stopped trusting and settled for something much less? The level path, continuing to trust the Lord, is always best, to honor the Lord and allow him to deal with the situation. Later on, Peter says this, "Let those who suffer according to God's will entrust their souls to a faithful Creator while doing good." While doing good. That's hard to do, isn't it? Seems impossible sometimes not to revile when we're reviled against and so on. We need to pray that prayer that David prayed, "Teach me your way, O Lord." Ephesians 4, 31 through chapter 5, verse 2. Paul says this, "Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you along with all malice. Be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ forgave you. Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children, and walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice. You might have noticed I emphasized a couple phrases. As God in Christ, as Christ loved us. It's a command. Paul tells us to get rid of the junk and put on the kindness and tenderheartedness and forgiving and love. But there's grace. There's grace not only to do those things and fulfill and be obedient to that command. There's grace before that. As God has forgiven you, we are forgiven. Therefore, we have the ability in Christ to forgive others. We have been shown love. Therefore, we can love others. Very important phrases, and I think David is leaning upon God's character and his promises and his proven worth when he prays, teach me your way, so they don't stoop to their level of the enemies. Jesus, you are the pure and spotless Lamb, and you have forgiven us and has purchased new life by your blood. Lord, help us to forgive and to walk in love. Help us to imitate your love. Amen. And the final reason that we see in Psalm 27 is found in verse 13 and 14, that God will complete what he started. I believe that I shall look upon the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord, be strong, and let your heart take courage. Wait for the Lord. There's no indication that David's situation is any different. Yet David is unwavering in his faith, and it's based upon God's character and upon God's promises. The phrase in verse 13, probably better translated, I would have despaired unless I had believed that I will look upon the Lord in the land of the living. There's this desperation. David's saying, if I didn't believe, if I didn't know, if I didn't trust in who God is and his promises, I'd be full of despair. David's confidence of assurance, of assurance of eternal life, and we have that same assurance. And you could even argue that we have a greater assurance because we know Christ is risen. And if he is risen, he is seated at the Father's right hand, and those who have faith in Jesus Christ are also raised and seated with him. See, one truth guarantees the other. If Christ is raised, then those who are his will be raised. So we too can say, as David says, I believe that I shall look upon the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. The conclusion of the matter. Verse 14, and again, this is David potentially talking to the congregation, saying, therefore, wait for the Lord. Be strong and take courage. Wait for the Lord. Or is there another way to think about it? And I think it's God's word from him. Almost as if God was responding by saying this, okay, David, okay, everybody else. Wait for the Lord. Based on who I am, based on what I've done, based on my promises, wait for the Lord. Be strong and take courage. We are a hurting people. The prayer chain emails and conversations we have is very evident of that. And learning to trust the Lord, as we see here that David was doing, it's a process. A long, tiring process. It was brought to mind, but when God says, wait for the Lord, brought to mind a little kid at the edge of a pool where mom and dad is in there saying, jump, I'll catch you. Everything will be okay. And the mental gymnastics that the little one is going through of that's really deep water, it's scary, I've never done this before. Will my floaties work? And is daddy lying to me? Is he gonna be distracted? Can he catch me? Is mommy gonna lift me up if I sink too low? Have they ever lied to me before? Is daddy good? Is mommy caring for me? We can have the same mentality, the same reasoning when we're facing something difficult. is God who he says he is? Is God really the God who he's revealed himself to be? Has God really fulfilled some of his promises, and therefore, because he said he will he fulfill more? Our strength and our confidence, our trust in him, we can have it if we put our faith in him. It's like Jesus says, don't be troubled, believe in me. So with eagerness, with expectancy, let us wait for the Lord. God himself is worth the wait. He's worth the pursuit. So let's wait. And let's keep on waiting. Let's seek him and keep on seeking.
If you have questions about what you've just heard, or if you want to know more about what it means to follow Jesus Christ, I want to encourage you to check out our website, faithbfc.org. If you live in the Harleysville area and you're not part of a local church, we'd love to have you worship with us here at Faith. I look forward to meeting with you personally. But whether you live here or somewhere else, the important thing is to get plugged into a local church where you can grow in your walk with Jesus Christ and help others grow as you serve him.